Hallelujah! Jesus Christ is Lord. Let's worship Him. Let's lift His name. Let's open our hearts to Him that He can go in and clean it and bless it on this Passover time. Amen. Hallelujah. Worship the Lord. Lift your hands. The Bible says, lift up your holy hands and receive from Him. Testify of You, be a witness of Jesus Christ. Fill my love with Holy Spirit, Lord. Fill my love with Holy Spirit, Lord, so that I can testify of You. Be a witness of Jesus Christ. You want to be a witness for the Lord, especially in this last hour. Yes.
Until the whole world loves my Jesus, their Lord. I want more.
them, Lord Jesus.
I will go and testify of you.
Oh, yes, so.
I'm a witness of Jesus.
Yes.
Fill my lamp with Holy Spirit. Oh, fill my lamp with Holy Spirit.
Say, I will go.
I will go and testify of you. Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah. 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 Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Man, that song is fire. That is what we all need. Fresh oil. Fresh oil from God. Do not quench your spirit. So we need the fresh oil from the Lord. We need a touch every day from God to keep us going. You know, we are vehicles for Jesus Christ. And sometimes we get weary. We run out of gas. And we need the Lord to fill us. Amen. So I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that we will be blessed. Have you guys been? I have missed you guys and I love you guys. I know it's been a while, but you know, God is the one who says when, right? So I just wait and go with the Lord. But he has an awesome message for us. And I hope you are ready to receive this message from the chef of all chefs. Amen. Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And I'm here as a waitress to serve. In Jesus' name, let us pray. Hallelujah. Father, we come before you in your precious, majestic, holy name. Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. The wonderful counselor, the Prince of Peace, the Rabbi, you're the excellent teacher. My goodness, Lord, teach your daughters. Teach me as I'm here as a vessel, surrendering to you to use me. So here I am, Lord. Take over, speak through me, feed us, convict us, change us, heal us. Do what you do, oh God. Do what you do. We bind every evil spirit in the name of Jesus Christ that will try to distract, discourage, deceive, whatever, go in the name of Jesus Christ. You're not welcome in this room in Jesus Christ's name, or that room, wherever the person is, whether it's evening, morning, afternoon. We bind you in the name of Jesus Christ, every evil spirit. And I pray that, Lord, your spirit will be in each sister home, if they're at work, if they're driving, if they're in their house. I don't know, Lord, you know where they are. I pray that you will be with them. You will be so upon them to touch them, especially those that are struggling with this demon, that they will overcome today, that they will be set free today by the power of the Holy Ghost, the Ruach HaKodesh, Rohom Takatif. Set them free. Thank you, Lord, that I can talk about this because I don't struggle with it. I don't want to be a hypocrite. So, Father, thank you that you set me free to be able to teach this. So, Father, have your way, and may I be an excellent example for my sisters. May an excellent spirit be upon me. In the mighty name of Jesus Christ, I give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. Have your way, Jesus. Love you. Amen. Hallelujah. All right. Today's message is on the prison of unforgiveness. Get your pen and your notepad or paper, whatever you can write on. Let's go ahead and get right into it because I know you probably got a busy day. So the prison of unforgiveness. Bear with me because I have a lot of notes. I'm going to be looking at my book a lot, but I'm here. Amen. All right. So we have to understand that unforgiveness is a sin. For us to be forgiven, we must forgive. Amen? So it's basic 101. I hope I said it correctly. It's basic 101. It's the first teachings, I believe, Jesus just kept teaching his students, his disciples, and he's still teaching us. Forgiveness, it's a must. You must forgive. No matter what you've gone through in life, you must forgive. And we're going to go through a bunch of different people. Let me not say a bunch, you know, like but probably like five or four that we see that they really showed forgiveness. in very tough times, but they still did. With the power of the Lord, you can do what? You can do all things through Christ who gives you the strength. Hallelujah. So what is unforgiveness? Sis, what is unforgiveness? So what is unforgiveness? Unforgiveness. Unforgiveness is when a person can be unwilling, not willing to forgive someone what they went through, whether it was trauma, you know, just deep wound, deep pain, betrayal, somebody broke their trust, and it just causes deep emotional pain, intense pain. Do you know there are three different types of unforgiveness? Three types of unforgiveness. The first one is unforgiveness towards others, and that's what we're going to be covering today, unforgiveness towards others. The second one is unforgiveness towards God. Why would somebody be like that with God? God is perfect. He don't make mistakes. He's perfect. Awesome. Think of what he did for us. But today we're not talking about that. Then the third one is unforgiveness towards yourself. Yeah. Unforgiveness towards yourself. You know, sometimes we've all made bad decisions, you know, when we're lost in the world, or even sometimes in Christ, made bad decisions, and it keeps trying to replay over and over in the mind, and one keeps kind of condemning themselves. I got a word for you. Turn your Bible to 1 John 3, 20, chapter 3, verse 20. 1 John chapter 3, verse 20. Amen. Bear with me. I definitely need a new Bible. This one is, the pages are kind of, but I love it. Have you ever been there? You just have a, you know, that favorite Bible and you don't want to part ways with it. Yeah, that's me with this one right now. But anyways, 1 John chapter 3, verse 20. Let's read it together. In Jesus Christ's name. For if our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart. You heard that? If our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart and knoweth all things. Beloved, if our heart condemn us not, then have we confidence towards God. Amen. So you see, here the Lord is saying, if our heart condemn us, we have a great, great God. He knows all things. So if we confess and talk about it, God takes care of it, you know? And then he says in the next verse, like, beloved, if our heart condemn us not, then we have confidence toward God. So it's a secret, something interesting here. You know, the Lord is talking about, if our heart condemn us not, then have we confidence towards God. That means we have to have confidence who God is, what he says he will do. You know, if you have confidence in what God can do for you, your heart is not going to play games with you, because you know that God is faithful and that you are saved. If you're living in God's ways, you're saved. You know, you're practicing righteousness, holiness. But we know we are righteous through Christ, right? So we trust God to help us to walk this walk. It's not an easy walk. He said, you're going to go through many hardships on this earth. But we have to have faith in him. He's going to help us overcome every trial, tribulation, persecution. He's there, you know, so we have to hold on to Jesus Christ to help us. So be comforted with that, beloved. If your heart condemns you, that means you don't have confidence in God. Why, girl? Jesus Christ is awesome. The more you draw closer to him, he reveals himself to you. And you have such a peace to know that God loves you no matter what. His love is unconditional. But just don't keep practicing sin, because then you push him away. You know, he promises to never leave you nor forsake you. But if you keep practicing sin, then he backs away because God is holy. All right. And the unforgiveness towards God, that's a person struggling with doubt, doubting who God is. They've gone through things in life, some things they caused, or some things, it was just a test that God put before them. And they start blaming God. You know, if God is real, if God cares, why is he allowing this? Why is he allowing that? Gotta trust God. The Bible says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding. Acknowledge him in all your ways, and he will direct your path. He will direct your path. All right? Praise the Lord. Let Jesus Christ be your great physician. Let him be that surgeon. Let him be the one that goes in there and he touches your heart and he fixes it. If he can only do that if you allow him. He can't work on you if you're not surrendering. Even the Bible says, surrender unto the Lord. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Resist the devil and watch him flee. All right? So you have to surrender to the Lord. You got to surrender that unforgiving spirit. You got to cast it down. You got to lay it on that altar and say, Lord, I don't want this. I don't want this. Lord, it's destroying my life. And God will start working on you if you truly, sincerely want to be a person that forgives others and know that God has forgiven them. If you don't believe God has forgiven you, there you go. You're allowing that condemning spirit to attack. So you got to believe that God's forgiven you. God doesn't remember anymore the things that you did. It's done. Press forward. You know, God's real. When he says he's forgiven, he's forgiven. You just have to receive that love, believing that God loves you. All right? Because say most of us have been wounded, you know, by somebody we trusted. And that's why Christ is that great physician, is that wonderful surgeon that goes in and he fixes that spot. What the enemy does is that the enemy likes to replay and replay over and over the things he used people to try and hurt us. You know, whether it was molestation, rape, mean words, abuse, you know, however the enemy used a person to try and cause you to have a cold heart. He's getting exposed today in the name of Jesus Christ. And I just hope you're ready. You're ready to receive the truth, and you're not going to harden your heart towards the Lord's word, but you're going to open up and believe. You know, I was one of those people that when I gave my life to the Lord, I'm almost 17 years in the Lord. My first year with Christ, oh my goodness, because I came from a very bad relationship. This guy didn't like beat the old me, but he messed with my mind mentally. He like messed with the mind, you know, the old mind, not this mind. This is the new mind in Christ. Hallelujah. You know, and it was so hard for me to like forgive him when I finally was able to get out of that relationship with the help of the Lord and my husband came through, you know. And it just seemed the difference of how a man should treat a woman, you know, and it was beautiful, praise God. But so I was able to walk out of there. And but of course, there was the process now of healing for me, you know, and trusting the man that God had called for me to be with, you know, to know that he's not like that guy. So please put your walls down. So it took time for the Lord to really work with me. And I was willing. I was willing because I had read, if I don't forgive, God ain't going to forgive me. And I'm like, okay, I'm going to be wasting time talking to Jesus, but he's not going to hear my prayers because I'm struggling with, at that time, I was struggling with unforgiveness. Not now. So I reject those words in the name of Jesus Christ. We got to be careful with our tongue. We don't want to speak that over ourselves, right? Anyway, amen. But at that time, you know, the old, new me in Christ, baby me in Christ, was struggling with unforgiveness. And God, you know, really helped me. And Jesus is such an awesome friend, for real. He's my best friend. I hope he's your best friend. I really hope he's your best friend. May you not have anyone or anything before Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ should be number one in your life. And what he hates, you should hate. And what he loves, you should love. And if he tells you to do this, you must do it. Amen? Because you love him. Your desire is to please the Lord. Your desire is to put a smile on God's face. Because he takes good care of you. Why not obey him and give him, you, a body living sacrifice unto him, holy, ready to do God's work? So that replaying is called the wilderness. The enemy wants to bring a person to the wilderness. The spirit of unforgiveness opens the spirit door for the anger, revengeful spirit, sadness, crushed spirit, just a misery, miserable spirit, depression. And God forbid, sometimes people actually take their own lives. They take their own lives because the demons really mess with their mental. They just make it feel like nobody loves you, nobody cares. Look at you, you're a loser. You know, and the person doesn't understand. Okay, these are evil spirits lying to me. They're like, whatever. They even say like, kill yourself. Oh yeah, I had a sister. Thank you, Lord. She's in a better place now. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. I had a sister that and sis, if you're watching this, mwah, Jesus loves you and I love you. You're actually coming into the sermon, the teaching of Christ. It's amazing. He just poured you on me, on my mind right now. And I hope that things are getting better for you and your mom, you know. But the sister, you know, she went through a lot, you know, as a child. Didn't feel the love, the affection of the mother. And, you know, as she got older, she's in Christ. I'm just fast forwarding. Unforgiveness was bothering her. It was bothering her. It was attacking her. It was attacking her towards her mom, just letting it go, letting go. What? How can, she, you know, she act like she's an awesome grandparent to the children, because she has children, beautiful children, you know, and she wasn't a mother to her. So the enemy would try to really attack her, try to make her feel like she's a bad mom. You know, there was just so much going on. And there was even a time the enemy tried to attack her with suicidal thoughts. You know, like, oh, just throw yourself down those stairs. You're useless, you know. Like, these demons are real. These are ancient spirits. They've been here. They know. They've studied mankind. They know mankind's weakness. That's why we have to be covered in the blood of Jesus Christ. We got to have the full armor of God daily, you know? And so, yeah, suicidal, it does. These demons try to cause a person to just take their lives, you know? Because when they know if that person takes their life, they're not going to enter the kingdom of heaven. No way. That life is not yours to take. Mm-mm. No way. If there's any of you watching this, in the name of Jesus Christ, I bind that evil spirit of suicide. I bind you, suicide, in the name of Jesus Christ. And I pray for you, sister, that you will know you're loved by the Lord and that you're loved by me. You're loved by so many. Those that are in this ministry, you're not alone. Don't believe the lies of Satan. Don't sit and indulge in the food that Satan's trying to give you. Reject that food. It's venom. He's trying to destroy your soul. Don't accept it. Don't accept it. 2 Corinthians, if you can go to it. Amen. Praise the Lord. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3. And we can just start reading from verse 5, okay? When you get a chance to read 2 Corinthians chapter 10, all of it, okay? Because time is going here. In Jesus Christ's name, casting down imaginations. No, let's go to 4. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. Okay? Not carnal. What are they? Man, spiritual warfare, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. So we use God's word to pull these, what? Strongholds down. Okay, we don't fight with flesh and blood. You don't fight with that person that, you know, tried to mess with your life. You fight those demons that are using that person to try to make your life miserable. You use God's word. There's power in God's word. Just have to believe what you're saying, that it will come to pass. Life and death are in the power of your tongue. And if you speak life, you're going to see results of life. Beautiful, beautiful life. You speak death, you're going to see death just grow, curses, and you don't want that. So speak life, okay? So casting down, verse 5, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. And right here is a perfect example of the sister I was telling you about. They were trying to exalt themselves in her mind, telling her, like, just throw yourself in those stairs. Nobody cares. Oh, la, la. You know, all those are imaginations. You want to cast them down and don't fall victim to the devil's lies. All right. So read that on your own time. You know, another one is Matthew chapter 6, verse 14 to 15. Let's go right to it. Hebrews 12:29, for our God is a consuming fire. Hebrews 12:29, for our God is a consuming fire. Yeshua, Holy Messiah, Emmanuel is consuming fire. Yeshua, Holy Messiah, Emmanuel is consuming fire. Hebrews 12:29, for our God is a consuming fire. Hebrews 12:29, for our God is a consuming fire. Yes, that's a spiritual warfare song, marching in your house and singing it, believing what you're saying in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. All right. Matthew chapter 5, verse 44. Matthew chapter 5, verse 44. In Jesus Christ's name, I say unto you, love your enemies, bless them that curse you, do good to them that hate you, and pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. You see, Jesus is telling us to love our enemies. The world teaches us to hate our enemies. Hate them, kill them, destroy them, make their life miserable. Don't forgive that person that did that to you. No, Jesus says, love them, forgive them that persecute you, hate you, and despitefully use you. All right? So that you may be known as the children of God, and it brings glory to God. Amen. Now, glory to yourself, glory to God. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. Amen. Hallelujah. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. You know that one, right? You know that one. You know that one. Amen. You probably memorized it. Let's do it. 1, 2, 3. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, rulers of the darkness of this world, in spiritual wickedness in high places. You see, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. It's not against black and white, or, you know, no. It's the evil spirits, the evil principalities. These beings that have been here for quite some time, we fight against them with the power of Christ, with the word of God, the word of Jesus Christ. And just continue reading. You know, it tells you about the whole armor, put on the shield of faith, and, you know. So these are some signs of what we've encountered, that, you know, when the Holy Spirit allows us to see in the Spirit, you know, it's called the word of knowledge. He will reveal to us what a person is going through. Okay. And so some signs of unforgiveness that we've encountered when we do deliverance prayers, or even just ministering, is one, you can write this down if you probably struggle with it or you know someone that does struggle with it. It can be helpful to, you know, to you or that individual. Amen. Burst of anger. You know, this is uncontrollable anger, like just, that used to be the old me. Yeah, yeah, yeah. When people see me, they're like, no way, not you. Yeah, yeah, yeah. My husband knows. He was in my life. He's seen it. The old me had such bad anger problem. It was ungodly, just ungodly. A violent individual, you know. But, you know, it gets deep. That came through fornication, the transferring of evil spirits, you know. But that's a teaching from another time, you know. If you're fornicating, one, you're damning your soul to hell. Two, you're damning that person you're laying down with that's not your husband, soul to hell. You're changing, you're transferring unclean spirits towards each other. Your bed is defiled. God is not reckoning that, because you're not married. So stop fornication. Just think about this. God forbid, if you're caught in that act, and you die in that sin, you're not making it. The Bible says in Galatians, Corinthians, fornicators will not inherit the kingdom of God. So if you're fornicating, you better stop. You're playing with fire. You're playing with fire. You better stop. Yep. You wonder why you get all those weird thoughts going on. It's because your mind's confused. You're picking up the demons that are in that person, that person slept with, and that person's like, just stop. In Jesus Christ's name, if you love the Lord, that temple is of God. Why are you laying down with demons? The Bible says, be angry, but sin not. So there's good anger, you know? You can be angry because God gave us feelings, like we're bothered about something, like, oh man, I'm angry. But you're not sinning, you know? God, he didn't make us to be puppets. We're humans. He gave us feelings and, you know, he just wants us to have self-control and not anger that is unrighteous anger, you know, that doesn't produce good fruit. The other scripture I love, it says, anger resteth in the bosom of a fool. Okay? So people that get angry, like the Bible says, anger resteth in the bosom of a fool. You don't want to be called a fool. You don't want to be seen as a fool. Stop getting angry in an ungodly way. If you have to fast, fast that out of you in Jesus Christ's name. You know? Some of these kind don't come out but through prayer and fasting. That's what the word says. That's not what Lioness says. That's what the word of God says. So fast it. Second one we've seen is suppressed anger. You know, they just keep that. They keep it in, you know, they just keep it in, and it can cause anxiety and depression. You know, that's why it's good to talk with someone that is in the Lord and you can see the fruits of the Lord and explain to them what you're going through so they can pray. You could pray together. You could fast together in the name of Jesus Christ and be delivered, you know, because the Bible says where two agree in the name of Jesus Christ, it's done, right? But it's got to be someone that you know walks the walk and just not talks, but walks and talks. Amen. All right. The other thing, signs that we realize that people that are struggling with unforgiveness is they talk about what has happened to them a lot. Prisoner in the wilderness. They're just going in circles in that wilderness of what really happened. There was a sister we were ministering to, and man, her story was so sad, such a sad story, you know, and she just had GI problems. Excuse me if I don't pronounce it correctly, it's gastrointestinal issues. And we prayed and we're trying to figure out, Lord, what is the cause of this? You know, Lord, what is it? What is it? What is it? And the more we spoke to her, not only just the GI. She also had problems, I think, with her hands. Like, she would feel pain in her knees. and we just prayed that God will reveal to us what the issue was. But when we'd speak, especially me, when we'd talk, her and I, she would constantly bring back what she went through. Almost every conversation. And the Lord started revealing to me, because I would sit on the phone for almost an hour with her, because I'm, you know, love. I love people, and I care for God's people. You know, I don't want to see God's people like paralyzed. So I spend time, you know, but I learned my lesson, you know, I learned my lesson. She would not let it go, no matter how much. Showed scriptures. Even my husband, one time, he was part of the conversation, and he also seen that she really would not let go of the past. You know, Paul talks about forgetting the things behind and pressing forward. I believe it's in Philippians. She would just not let it go. It was such a deep wound inside of her. It's just terrible what had happened to her. She was, at a young age, I think, molested or raped, one of those, by her own father. Her own dad did that. He opened up those demons. He opened up that door. I don't know if this man was in some cult. I have no idea. Like, why would a father do that to a child, his own blood? Like, why? But again, it's demonic spirits in people that would do such things, you know? But anyways, she was really traumatized, because not only that did he do that to her, he ended up causing the mother and her to become enemies. You know, the mother did not like the daughter, really, like, hated her, you know? So she had no relationship with her mother. And then the father would sell her. So she became a prostitute at a very young age, very young age. And that's traumatizing. That's rough. Like, why? You know? But anyways, her story is sad. And I don't know if there's anyone watching this that has gone through something like that, or, you know, being raped. That's just, it's not right. It's not right. I don't know what to say, you know, but just, I'm sorry. I'm sorry that happened to you. May God bring healing to you. May you trust the Lord to touch you and to heal you from that, to make you forget. Because you don't want to miss heaven because of unforgiveness. Because this is what the sister went through. She just would not let go. And I think even the dad was dead. I think he died, you know, and she just would not let go. She had such a crushed spirit. Crushed spirit that her body, you know, because the Bible says in, I believe, Proverbs 17:22. We can turn to that, please. And please keep her in your prayers, because she's not part of the ministry anymore. She was caught in guile. She was caught, you know, doing some gossip. And when she was approached, she ran away, you know. So it's sad, but I believe it's just because of the demons she was already fighting, that she was trying to fight. That's the mistake. People try to fight these demons. You cannot fight them. Jesus fights them for you. The battle's not yours. The battle is the Lord's. All you got to do is stand firm, take your position, and let Jesus Christ do what? Fight it. He said it is finished on the cross. He finished the work. All you got to do is just stand firm, proclaim the word, and God does the rest. All right? Proverbs chapter 17, verse 22. It says, in Jesus Christ's name, a merry heart doth good like a medicine. A merry heart doth good like a medicine, but a broken spirit drieth the bones. What is a merry heart? It's a joyful heart, a joyful heart. And who gives that joy? Jesus Christ. It's part of the fruit of the Spirit. I think the second one, joy. You know, so a merry heart doth good like medicine. So when a person is joyful, they cause their body to be healthy. Mind, body, soul, and spirit. Healthy, healthy, healthy. But if a person has a broken spirit, a crushed spirit, an unforgiving spirit, you know, a bitter spirit, it dries the bone. It dries the bone. So that's a door that causes demons to bring sickness. Now let's see Matthew 18:34. What unforgiveness will do to a person that doesn't want to submit to God. Because basically that person doesn't want to submit to God. They don't. Because if they did, they know God wants them to be free from that. They will do what the Lord says, you know, and find healing. Find healing from letting go. Let it go. Let it go, sister. It's doing you no good. It's trying to destroy your body. Yeah, unforgiveness causes sickness. Yes, it does. We just read right here. A merry heart doth good like medicine, but a broken spirit drieth the bones. So listen to what unforgiveness does, okay? Verse 34, chapter 18. And his Lord, please read the whole chapter. So, you know, because I'm just trying, I got so much, and I'm just trying to, like, you know, not keep you guys here for 3 hours, you know. So verse 34. And his Lord was wroth and delivered him to the tormentors till he should pay all that was due unto him. So you see right here, because of this person, you just read the story. They didn't do what they're supposed to do, you know, and they ended up attracting evil ones to start tormenting them. You know, so when a person doesn't forgive, they actually open the door for evil spirits to begin to torment them. And if you've ever watched Derek Prince's sermon on demon gangs or something like that, it's one of that. Leave a comment down there. You know what it's really called. He broke it down how these demons don't just, they open the door for other demons to come in. You know, so the spirit of unforgiveness will bring in the spirit of pride. I believe unforgiveness, the root cause of it is pride. That person doesn't want to let go. You know, why was I treated like that? Why me? Like, you know, it just opens more demons to, like, why? Feeling sorry and bitter and then hatred. They just pile up, you know, because the whole point for these evil ones is to destroy the relationship the child of God has with the Father, Jesus, because the heart becomes defiled, you know, and God is holy. God is holy. He wants us to have clean hearts, you know, and so they begin to torment, you know, and I believe the sister here, she actually started seeing tormenting. She started being tormented. You know, I think there's times she couldn't even sleep, you know, these things will keep her up. You know, they do create health issues. I think I read somewhere it says like almost 61% of cancer patients struggle with unforgiveness, arthritis, you know, ulcers, blood pressure, just weak immune support. You know, the immune system just decreases and decreases because it's all spiritual. Life is spiritual. You know what I mean? So what we go through inside, it starts showing outside. You know what I mean? So it's important to fight the lies of the enemy. You know, bitterness does take joy. It takes the joy. I mean, look at what Jesus says. The devil comes to... Let's go to it. John 10:10. John 10:10. John 10:10. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. I kind of had a brain fart there. John 10:10. There we go. There. Are you there? Sorry, I've not even been asking you if you're there. Just pause the video. I'm so sorry. Okay. John 10:10. Amen. You want to read? Go ahead. All right. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly. Thank you, Jesus. You see that? Jesus said the thief comes to steal. What does he come to steal? Your joy, your peace, your blessings, your health. And then he wants to kill you. He's out to destroy. But Jesus, hallelujah, he came that we may have life abundantly, more, not just abundantly, more abundantly. You know, he's the good shepherd and he takes good care of his sheep, but his sheep got to be willing to let go. Amen. So if you're the person God's talking to about this, please take it to heart. Take it to heart. You got to leave that unforgiving spirit behind and move forward. All right. But if this message is not for you, you can send it to someone else to watch that is struggling with unforgiveness. You know, you can use it to minister to others. Hebrews 12:15 talks about bitterness. We can turn there. Wow, Lord, thank you. Hebrews 12:15. You there? Okay, in Jesus Christ's name. Looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Let's read that again. Looking diligently, diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of God. Man can fail of the grace of God. Why? Because they allow the root, their hearts to become like defiled with the spirit of bitterness. He said root, that's like down, like root, you know, like a tree. The tree of an apple or a mango can, it starts somewhere, right? There's a root. So there's a root for bitterness, and the root for bitterness is unforgiveness. That's what happens. The root for bitterness is unforgiveness because the person did not work on that. So it opened up doors for bitterness to come in, and bitterness opened up the door for pride and envy and hatred and jealousy and gossip. And no, it just keeps going and keeps going and keeps going. That's why you got to cut from the root. Axe, cut it in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. So you don't become defiled. It's real. It's very real. And then the other thing is the cold heart. A cold heart that we've seen, that we're still on the signs that we've encountered. Well, one is struggling with unforgiveness, a cold heart. A person has a cold heart, you know. You can just feel it and sense it, you know, even before they get close to you. Like, you just could tell this person is cold inside. But I'm here to tell you today, if you're that person that's got a cold heart, Jesus Christ loves you, and he wants to make that heart hot for him. Okay, tell that devil to leave in Jesus Christ's name. Tell him to leave. He's a liar. Don't believe in that. Turn to Jeremiah 17:9. This is for you. Amen. Jeremiah 17:9. Okay, you want to read that, sis? Read that. Jeremiah 17:9. Jesus Christ's name. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. You see that? Who can know it? Only God. I, the Lord, search it. I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doings. See, God goes in and he searches our hearts. You know, he searches our hearts. I hope I didn't mess with that. The mic is right on me right here. God goes in and he searches our hearts, you know, and he will give each one a verse. And God goes in and he searches our hearts, and he will give each one of us according to our own ways. So if we choose to walk in a way that is pleasing unto the Lord, God is pleased with that, and he blesses our hearts. He takes care of us. And if one chooses to walk in a way that is rebelling against God, God allows things to start happening in that heart, you know, and they start getting deceived by their own heart. That's why the Bible says the heart is deceitful above all things, you know, so don't trust your heart. Trust the Lord. Okay. The heart is deceitful. So the other one. Thank you, Lord. All right. Thank you guys for your patience as I'm gathering these notes together. Amen. So basically, if one doesn't forgive, I don't want to speak it over you, you know, but there are some of you that honestly are struggling with unforgiveness. God told me, struggling with unforgiveness. So for those that are not, it's not for you. But you know you're struggling. You know yourself. You know your heart. Amen. If you don't forgive, sis, you have given yourself to the tormentors. So they torment you, whether you're unable to sleep at night, no joy, no peace. And there's also like, you're not seeing blessings from the Lord. Like, it's like you feel like your life is cursed, you know? It's because you opened up that door. So you have to shut that door. And the only way you can shut that door is you confessing, for real confessing, that you struggle with unforgiveness. You struggle forgiving your dad. You struggle forgiving your sister. You struggle forgiving your husband. You struggle forgiving your mother-in-law, your mother. You struggle forgiving that co-worker. You struggle. You have to shut that door, sis. You got to let it go. Let it go in the name of Jesus Christ. You got to have the same mind that was in Christ Jesus. To have a spiritual mind is life. To have a carnal mind is death. So you don't want to have a carnal mind. You want to have a spiritual mind. Amen? So fight it in the name of Jesus Christ, because you can do all things through Christ who gives you the strength. He's ready. He's ready to help you. Amen? You can overcome. Through the blood of Jesus Christ, you're an overcomer. Remember that. Amen. So we're talking still about what unforgiveness does to a body. I don't know if you've ever seen a person that struggles with arthritis. I'll show you here. You can look. Arthritis. So arthritis, as you can see, the bones are dry. They're like kind of life. There's like little life in there. It's crooked. And I was learning a little bit about it. It says, and I'll read what I picked up. It says, arthritis is caused by a fault in the immune system that causes the body to attack its own tissues in the joints. See, these demons, they attack from inwardly, right? And then they start disfiguring the body of that individual. And this comes back to that scripture we're talking about. A broken, a crushed spirit, unforgiving spirit, dries the bone. Dries the bone. It's real. It really is real. You know, sometimes people, you see them go to doctors. Instead of running to Jesus Christ first and saying, okay, Lord, what's going on here? What is this? And God, so faithful and so kind, he says, ask and he shall be given. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be open. God is faithful. Got to run to him first, not man. You know, he talks about a person that puts confidence in man. You know, we're supposed to trust the Lord because God has the answers. He's the potter and you're the clay. All right, so he knows what's going on with the clay. And God will reveal to the person what's going on with their body, you know, who probably advised the person to go on a fast and, you know, get their body cleansed. But we see that arthritis, as we can see this picture, you know, in different other pictures, it's a person's probably struggling with unforgiveness of what they went through. And I used to work with the elderly, you know, miss working with the elderly. Lovely, lovely, lovely. You know, I still love, especially working with the ladies, elderly, you know, because I'll doll them up, you know, just see old pictures of them when they were young and we'll sit and just chat. But anyways, and I will see like their hands are just like crooked, you know, they're like turning. And the more I would speak to them, you know, they'll tell me about their life. And then some, you could just hear them, like when they bring about their children, you know, I remember now that they felt rejected, you know. That's another thing God is just telling me. Rejection can also, you know, if a person doesn't confess and seek God, it can also start causing sickness in the body because they just feel like, I'm rejected, nobody cares. And the enemy uses that and he runs with it. And the person, if they're not strong in the Lord, they again open up a door. So they would talk about their children, how they don't come visiting them. It's been a month and I haven't even seen my son. And, you know, my daughter is all the way in Kentucky. And, you know, I was in Massachusetts at that time. So you just feel their pain, you know. So I would really sit and chat with them and talk with them and just make them feel the love. And I didn't even know Christ. You know what I mean? I didn't even know Jesus, but I just always have loved people, you know. Thank you to the Lord. That's from God. Nothing to do with me. You know, so, but we see that the inward of a person that's struggling with unforgiveness, sickness attacking it, the outer shell starts revealing what's going on inside. You know, and the sad part is that some people have died, you know, with that bitter, that unforgiving spirit, and they end up just going to hell. You know, they end up burning, and then they're going to burn the second death, you know. They're going to burn in the lake of fire because they did not want to forgive the person or persons that did that to them. So it is important, guys, no matter what we do encounter in life, you know, even me still 17 years old, I have encountered people that have treated me wrong, you know, and it hurts, you know. You grow to love somebody, get to know somebody, but then they turn to be snakes or just haters, and what do? You know, you love them, forgive them, pray for them, that God is going to, you know, stop them in their way to Damascus, for God just to turn their life around, allow something to happen, just to remind them that God is not pleased by their actions, you know, and that they need to repent. All right. Amen. So, hey, my husband and I do go through it. We do go through it. We get slandered, you know. But it's made us very, very strong. Glory to God. You know, the Bible talks about when one goes through experience, it gives them hope and it just makes them really strong for the Lord. Yeah. So be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Amen. All right. Praise God. Praise God. God is reminding me of another incident of a sister. We were about to do a deliverance prayer over her. And we made sure, my husband's always like, forgive, and, you know, anybody that's had a deliverance prayer done by my husband, you know, he always brings up, forgive those that have hurt you. And this one woman can't say sister. She was a woman. This is years back, years back in Massachusetts. She had such a hard time forgiving this person that did them wrong. You know, because when we were praying, remember, she had already said, yeah, I forgive, you know. I don't think she took it serious. So when we were praying, there was such a barrier. It's like nothing was happening, you know, because we've seen things happen. Glory to God, like demons manifest and just, yeah. When people that really believe they have demons inside of them and they don't want those demons in them, and they come in contact with the power of the Lord, they are ready. They are ready to get those things out. And then you find people, some people that are still like, I don't know if it's they don't believe. I have no idea, you know, what it is that just causes them not to be genuine, you know. She wasn't genuine. When she said she forgave, she wasn't genuine, and that's why there was a barrier. And so we had to stop and sit down and start ministering to her. And I was telling her, I was like, sis, if you die today, God forbid, you're not going to make it in. Why? It's because you have unforgiveness. You're still holding that person hostage, but you're actually holding yourself. You think you're punishing that person, but you're punishing yourself. That's something you gotta know. So we started telling her and whatever God was putting in our hearts. And then we're like, are you ready to do this now? And, you know, we mentioned the lake of fire. You know, it's good to let people know, like, don't play with your soul. You're going to end up burning for eternity, you know? And that's, God don't want none to perish. We don't want you to perish, you know? And so when we got done ministering, we said, let's do this again. And I told her, block everyone. It's just you and the Lord. Jesus is ready to deliver you. This time she really forgave, okay? She forgave this person. And you know what was so interesting, what she said after we got done, she's like, wow, I feel like I can breathe again. We said, what? She's like, yeah, she said she had something sitting on her chest, you know, and immediately we knew, like, that was that demon of unforgiveness. It was sucking life out of her, and it was so deep in there, it didn't want to cause her to, you know, kick that demon didn't want to get kicked out. Because, you know, when these demons, they love being in humans because they want to live their life in the humans, you know. And so when it got kicked out by the power of the Holy Ghost, hallelujah, this girl was set free. You could even see the glow on her, you know, the freedom. She was able to breathe. She was able to feel the peace, you know, and she testified. You know, and it just showed what Jesus says in Matthew 6:14. If you forgive, I'll forgive you, right? I mean, we could turn right to it. Take these notes down, especially those that are struggling with this. It's good stuff. So yes, in Jesus Christ's name. For if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespass. You see, because she wasn't willing to forgive the first time, God wasn't hearing her. God wasn't going to move and do anything. But when she did, for real, Father God forgave her. And she was able to be set free from that demon that was holding her hostage. Okay? So praise God. Praise God. I hope you guys are loving this teaching, because I loved it. I really loved it, and it just keeps me on my toes, like, hey, don't let any unforgiveness try to come in you, just, you know, because that person really did that to you. You were very, like, growing to really feel a connection. Don't, you know. I've been hurt even with family members, you know. And if you're watching this, I love you. I'm not gonna call out your name, no, but You know, I forgave you. Nakupenda. Kwa jina Yesu Kristo, mimi nakupenda. Si shida. You know, this is a testimony to testify how God allows us to go through things in life, you know, to be able to testify and tell another one, like, hey, I've been there. And through the power of the Holy Ghost, I got out of there, you know? So I got out of there because the Lord helped me. I cried and I felt so hurt. I felt like a dagger was, you know, put inside of me, you know, especially when it's family members. It's like, you grew up with them, you know, as if you grew up close, you know, because some family members, they don't grow close, you know. And but anyways, yeah, so I've been there, you know, and I remember this one was so tough. I had to like go on a fast, you know, I had to fast because I felt like my heart was getting cold and I was not going to have that because I've seen so much things by the grace of God. He's allowed me to see so many supernatural things, you know, and just I've tasted the goodness of God. I wasn't going to allow that spirit to try to destroy my relationship with my Jesus, you know. I wasn't. I wanted to do what Jesus told me to do. And it was a test. He put me through that test so I can be able to sit here and today talk about this with you guys, you know. And that's the reason why sometimes God will put us through things, is to train us and to mold us to be strong soldiers for Him and to be able to share our testimony with someone who's going through it. Be like, I can do it. If I can do it, you can do it. But we can only do it through the power of the Holy Ghost, through the help of Jesus Christ. But we have to be willing. You see, I was willing. And that's why God helped me. He said, get in a fast. Okay, get in a fast. When you're fasting, you got to go in the secret place. And that's how you're going to fight those demons in the name of Jesus Christ. You're calling them out, coming against them, you know, with the power of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's how you fight these evil spirits. Fasting is very important, especially if it's a strong demon. You want to really, really fast. Some people probably need 7 days of fast. Some people probably need 10. Some people probably need 3 or 1 day. But, you know, it's what God puts in your heart. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 27. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Neither give place to the devil. Okay? When a person don't let the devil have a hold of your mind or heart, you know, you let the devil have a hold of your mind, he's gonna take over it. He's going to take over it, you know. And how does one let the devil have a hold of his mind? Because he says, neither give place to the devil. Is when the devil brings that thought of like, oh, how dare that person. Remember what that person did to you? Remember what that person said about you? That is like him trying to take over your mind, you know. So he's replaying. Just like we said before, this is don't give place to him. Don't give place to the devil. Don't give place to the devil. You have to be alert. You have to pray for a sound mind, a clear mind, you know, so you're able to see the enemy when he's coming. Because the Bible says the devil roams around like a roaring lion, seeking who he may devour. Seeking who he may destroy. And that's how he comes. He comes, whispers, tries to get in the mind, thinking, oh, he gets into the heart, gets that heart cold, unforgiving, bitter, and all that. That's his tactics. You gotta have power over your mind through the name of Jesus Christ, through the power of the Holy Ghost. And that's why you gotta study your word daily. Try to memorize scriptures that when the enemy tries to throw things your way, you fight with the word of God, the sword of the spirit. You fight in Jesus Christ's name. And you fight also with praising, you know, singing songs. It really, the devil hates it. He hates when you sing songs to the Lord. All right. So guard your mind, guard your heart. You know, we've already gone through it. Pray, read, fast. You know, just listening to sermons. Sermons, obviously. David Wilkerson, my honey, I love you. You know, David Wilkerson's my first, and then my husband, of course, second, and then Derek Prince, third. You know, these men are a blessing. Listen to sermons of mighty men of God that really teach you how to war in the spirit, how to become a strong soldier in the battle that is not tossed back and fro with demonic spirits, but is firm, stands firm, you know, in who God has called them to be. The Bible says, and I believe it's in Timothy, a soldier is not entangled with the cares of this world. You know, we're in this world, but we're not of this world. We are soldiers. When we gave our lives to the Lord, we signed up for a battle. We signed up, you know. When we were living in the world, we were slaves for the enemy. Now we're slaves for Jesus Christ. Yeah. Amen. He treats us so good. The enemy, he didn't treat us good. He hated us, still hates us. He wanted to destroy us. You know, it's by the grace of God I'm sitting here today alive. The enemy had me, had the old me, very bad. You know, very bad. I'm so surprised how I'm still alive and here, you know. It's by God's grace. Amen. By God's grace. So be vigilant, because the enemy, he ain't playing with none of us. He wants many to go down to hell with them in the lake of fire. So keep yourself protected, so when the enemy comes, he finds you in the peace of God. He can't enter in because there's a wall of fire around you. Amen. Submit daily to the Lord. You know, submitting, surrendering to Christ. The more you do that, God draws closer to you. When God draws closer to you, he's the fire of God is burning in you. The devil sees, he runs. See, submit yourself unto the Lord. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Resist the devil and watch him flee. Okay, we've already talked about casting down imaginations. You know, fighting back with the word of God. Quoting the word of God. Some few examples that I love is Psalms 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. Romans 8:31. If God is for me, who can be against me? Ephesians 6:12. We know I wrestle not against flesh and blood. And Isaiah 54 verse 17. No weapons formed against you shall prosper. Amen. These are some of my to-go few examples of spiritual warfare. Scriptures that I love to use. And if I have to repeat it over and over and over, hallelujah, it works. Remember, the devil sees if you believe what you're saying. Never forget that. Your faith is what moves mountains. All right? Amen. So let us look at what forgiveness does. Because we were talking about unforgiveness, what unforgiveness will do. Okay, now let us look at what forgiveness does, why we should forgive. Amen. We should forgive because the Lord said we should forgive. We should forgive because we want peace with God. We want to be blessed. Amen. So when we forgive, we open up a pathway to a new place of peace, all right, which can only be found in Jesus Christ. You can find, we can read Philippians 4:7. Yay, I was right on it. Okay. Philippians 4:7. Jesus Christ's name. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. See, the peace of God, which passes all understanding, it will keep our hearts in mind through Christ Jesus. All right? So that's the beauty about forgiveness. is nothing like peace. I remember when I was lost in the world, I did not have peace. I barely slept. I barely slept. I was always high or drunk. Yeah, I was sad. It was that sad. I had a very sad life. Very sad life, you know, because I was walking with devils. I had opened up doors and I just wasn't healthy. Like, God allowed me to go through so much. And now I see Christ is the source of life. Christ is everything. When a person doesn't have Jesus Christ, they're lost. They're lost. We need Jesus Christ in our life. We need Jesus Christ in our life. He brings such beauty. Such beauty. God bless me with such a peaceful mind. I have such a sound mind. Of course, when I came to the Lord, I didn't have such a peaceful mind right away. No. Layers. We had to break through, Jesus and I. You know, he helped me and we did it together. And he taught me how to fight back. And my husband was always there helping and praying for me. And so, thank you, Lord. I am my husband's fruit. Basically, I am the fruit of my husband's labor. I just thank the Lord that God saved me and I'm able to bear fruit for Jesus, you know. And I give praise for my husband for being that warrior, prayed for me, loved me, taught me God's word. And here we are today working together, helping others to know the peace that is only in Christ Jesus, the hope, the deliverance, the love, the joy, so much in our Lord and Savior, just the blessings. The first one was God opens up a pathway to a new place of peace, which can only be found in Christ. All right. And you can also write Romans chapter 5, verse 1, because we read Philippians 4, 7. And then the next one is healing begins, you know, healing begins. And I love this in Exodus 15, 26. And truly healing begins when you really surrender to the Lord. Yeah, healing truly begins, you know. Wow. Okay, in Jesus Christ's name. And said, if thou will diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God, and will do that which is right in his sight, and will give ear to his commandments, and keep all his statutes, I will put none of these diseases upon you, which I have brought upon the Egyptians, for I am the Lord that healeth thee. See, God is the one that heals us, and God is also the one that allows sickness to hit a body. And if you read what he did to the Egyptians, you know, Moses, when Moses went to the mountain 40 years, came back to deliver the children out of Egypt, you know, God really sent lice, boils, what was it, hail, firstborns were killed, the firstborn sons were killed. Yeah, just go ahead and check it out yourself. If you haven't read that story, you can find that story in the book of Exodus, you know. But yeah, God is the God that healeth you, you know. The remedy, the remedy, the remedy, all the problems in your life. Do dawa, do dawa, do dawa, kwa kila shina maishani. Hallelujah. Amen. He is the remedy. He is the Lord, the God that healeth you. He's the God that healeth me. Hallelujah. Amen. Amen. Third is unclean doors. The unclean door of unforgiveness is shut. That demon, the demons, the unclean door of unforgiveness is shut. Jesus is the one that opens a door that no man can shut. And Jesus is the one that shuts a door that no man can open. So when Jesus shuts that door, keep it shut. Okay? Keep it shut. Don't open it again with, because somebody did this to you. Oh, I'm going to hold it. No, keep it shut. Pray for them. Get on your knees. Cry to the Lord. Keep that door shut. Hallelujah. The fourth one is your prayers are not hindered no more. Because when a person is holding a grudge, God don't hear those prayers. You know, 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 12. Okay. In Jesus Christ's name, for the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open unto their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. Right there. The eyes of the Lord are over the righteous. He keeps his eyes on the righteous. And his ears are open to them that do good. To them that are walking in the love of God, the obedience of God. You know, they're not holding any grudge. God listens to their prayers. But if a person's walking in rebellion, not wanting to forgive, their prayers are not heard. That's what God's word says. So if you've been wondering why God's not hearing your prayers, you got to let go of that unforgiveness. You got to let go of that bitterness. You got to let go of that seed of hatred. You just got to let go of it so your prayers are heard by God. All right? You want God to hear your prayers. You definitely do. When you forgive, you see more of God's blessings. Romans chapter 8, verse 28. I love it. Amen. Hallelujah. I hope you guys are enjoying this meal. Hallelujah. Amen. Because I am. I love this. I love this. Sharpens me more. In Jesus Christ's name. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the called according to his purpose. See, everything will work good to them that love God, to them that are called for God's purpose. You know, to them that practice righteousness, to them that are obedient, things will work out good for them. They will be blessed. They will be blessed going. They'll be blessed coming. They will not lack. Amen. That's the blessings of having a clean heart. It pleases the Lord. Number six, if you had health issues in due time with proving your repentance by your deed, you're going to see God heal you. In Jesus' name, he's going to heal you. You know, God healed me from so much, man, because I was obedient. Glory to God. He made me obedient. I can't do it. He did it through me. He did it through me. I just yield and he gave me the obedience to do it, you know. And I just started seeing the fruits of Jesus Christ, just the blessings, the health and doors open because I really let go. Remember that story I told you guys in the beginning about how I had a hard time like forgiving. Did I tell you guys that? If I didn't, excuse me. I had a hard time forgiving an ex-boyfriend. I think I did. Yeah. And that was a tough one, but God helped me. God really helped me. And I was so thin back then too, because I was sick. I was just like dying because drugs and depression and hatred in my heart at that time. You know, it was just so many demons. You should have seen how many demons came out of me. Oh my goodness. They were coming out, cutting me. It was, yeah, my testimony. Oh my goodness. Someday, Lord willing, I need to do it. I need to put it up to share with the world what Jesus really did for me. My husband experienced all that, so he can bear witness to everything I do say. Yeah, it was blood bleeding and just all that. They really were tearing the insides of me, coming out very, 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 very rough, you know. But man, what a blessing to be touched by the fire of God, the power of God. Amazing. Just gotta be willing. God's ready to do it. All right. Amen. So Matthew chapter 3, verse 8. We're still talking about, you know, if you know, you got health issues and you stay on this path of forgiving those that do you wrong and not holding anything, you know, against them, God will move forth and bless you and touch you. In Jesus Christ's name, bring forth therefore fruits meet for repentance. So prove by the way you live that you have really repented, you know. Show God that you are really done with that grudge and hatred and bitterness and you don't want it. God starts moving and touching the body, because God don't want you sick. He wants you in good health, you know. Amen. The seventh one is your mind becomes sound. You know, I believe we already spoke about this a little earlier there. Your mind becomes sound, you know. Because when one was walking in unforgiveness, like I said earlier myself, when I was growing in the Lord, I didn't have a sound mind. My mind was running with different things. And, oh, it was horrible. When I came to Christ and I tried to pray, whew, what a struggle it was to break through. It was so much going on in my mind. So much, you know, and can't please God like that. When you come to the Lord, it's focus. You and the Lord. Everything else, mm-mm. That's why he says, Matthew 6:6, when you pray, go into thy closet and shut thy door, you know, because that is a place that no one can come and distract you. But somehow the enemy will try to come and attack the mind and put thoughts that will distract the child of God to praying to the Father. So anytime you ever feel like you go in the closet and you're starting to get attacked in the mind, you can't even focus in praying, take your hands in Jesus Christ's name, be cleansed, and just speak to your mind. In Jesus Christ's name, this is the mind of Jesus Christ. No weapons formed against me shall prosper. I come against any unclean spirits sent my way to distract me. I break it in the name of Jesus Christ. I thank you, Lord. May the blood of Jesus Christ cover my mind. In Jesus Christ's name, amen. Hallelujah. You did it by faith. I feel blessed. And I wasn't even getting attacked, but I just feel really blessed, you know, just sincere prayers, God hears. A prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Amen. So pray over your mind if you feel attack. It works. Glory to God. Let the same mind that was in Christ Jesus be upon you. And that's why you read the Word of God. The Word of God renews your mind. It really renews your mind. When I came to Christ, I read a lot because I needed my mind to think pure thoughts. My mind just at that time was just evil, 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 you know. But God, I look back and I laugh what God really did. And sometimes I cry, you know, joy and then sadness. Oh my goodness, Lord, I really did that to you. You know, but praise the Lord for salvation, the free gift of salvation. We pray many can receive it, that they can open up their hearts and receive it, right? Ooh, I love this scripture. Isaiah 26:3. Aha. You're going to love this. Probably some of you already know it. Love this scripture. Love this scripture. Okay. In Jesus Christ's name, listen to this. Thou will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in you. You see that? So you will be in perfect peace if you keep your mind focused on God. Keep your mind fixed on God. Trust him, and God will take care of you. He'll give you that peace. Thou will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on the Lord, because he trusted in the Lord. Okay? Favorite scripture right there. Put that somewhere in the house. All right? Number 8. The joy of the Lord becomes your strength.
I love it.
The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength, is my strength. I said the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength, is my strength. I give thanks, I give thanks to my Jesus, to my Jesus. I give thanks, I give thanks to my Jesus, to my Jesus. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength, is my strength. I said the joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength, is my strength. I give thanks, come on, do you give thanks to our Jesus, to our Jesus.
Hallelujah. The joy of the Lord is your strength. See, when you have joy, you have strength. When a person has sadness, they have no strength. They're weak. So fight for your joy in the name of Jesus Christ, because we know the devil comes to what? Steal that joy. But don't let him. Don't let him, in Jesus Christ's name. And you can write name Nehemiah 8:10. Read it on your own time. I'm trying not to make this a long teaching, okay? Because if some of you are mothers, you know, you have so much to do and run around, I don't want you to feel like, oh, Lioness, why is it so long, you know? So I'm really trying my best, all right? Can't rush the Lord. So let's try to put this all together by the help of the Lord. So Nehemiah 8:10. That's for the joy of the Lord becomes your strength. A sad spirit can be around the joy of the Lord. Just can't. Can't. The enemy only comes to attack a person who allows him. You got to remember that. If you open that door, the enemy comes in like a flood. But if you keep it covered, protected in the name of Jesus Christ, he can't come in. He can walk around and look, but he can't come in. He can't. So be in the joy of the Lord in Jesus Christ's name, no matter what, how you feel. Try so much to be in the joy of the Lord. Run and pray. You know, it's part of our walk here on earth. Not every day I wake up like joyful. You know, the days I wake up, I'm like, I don't feel like getting off this bed, Lord. Yeah, it's true. But I trust the Lord and I get up and I go right into the closet. And the Lord touches me and I'm ready to walk the day with Christ in my house, serving with just joy because the Lord gave it to me. You know, I went and I asked. I said, ask and it shall be given. He's there to give it to you. Why believe the lies of the devil? Because you woke up feeling sad, or you woke up, had a bad dream, and you want to sit there and like, nah, cast it down, go pray and let God touch you and bless you, and you be a blessing for your household, or be a blessing at your workplace, or you be a blessing for your mom. Be a blessing. We're called to be a blessing, okay? And the devil tries to take the joy, so we're not a blessing. So get to learn his tactics, amen? More and more for those that know. Hallelujah. The ninth one is, remember, we're still on look at what forgiveness does. You're able to forgive easily. You know, when God allows you to go through pain or something in life, God forbid, but you're able to forgive easily. I speak through experience, you know, because he put me through the class of learning to forgive. He allowed different things to happen in my life, as well as my husband, and we learned to overcome through the power of the Holy Ghost. Because we're like, oh, remember, he did that. Yeah, he'd do it again. Oh, man, I love that person. Sad, like, why they would do that. We just come against those spirits that are lying to those to that person, and we bind and we pray that, God, you can touch that person's heart to see that they're doing wrong, that they don't die in their sins. And the more you pray for the person, the more the spirit of unforgiveness cannot even come closer to you, or bitterness, because you're really focused on God saving that person, you know. And truly, the prayer of a righteous man availeth much. If they're children of God, they're going to see their mistake, and they're going to reach out and mend, make it right, amend with the person. And they're going to reach out and make it right with the person. You know, we've seen it happen. You know, that's why it's, because the devil would do stuff like that to divide the body of Christ, to cause the one that's being hurt not to pray for that person. So that person can die and end up in hell. And then this person who's hurt can end up becoming paralyzed in their walk, and God forbid they die and they end up in hell. So it's important to allow God to work through you and teach you how to fight these fights with his power, okay? Because God created these beings. He knows, you know. So just trust God with your life and stop trying to fight this by yourself, because you will fail. Every single time, you will fail if you try to fight this by yourself. No, let Jesus do it. Here are some scriptures to help you forgive. Write this down. Matthew chapter 5, verse 23, 24. Matthew chapter 6, verse 12. Matthew chapter 7, verse 12. Mark chapter 11, verse 25. Luke chapter 11, verse 4. Luke 6, 31. Luke 6, 37. Matthew 18, 21 to 22. It's interesting. He said, forgive 70 times 7, right? Colossians chapter 2, verse 13 to 14. Then Colossians chapter 3, verse 13. You know, man, we have to bear with each other, you know, just bear with each other, help each other. Basically, help each other carry the cross. I mean, even Jesus Christ had Simon the Syrian help him carry the cross. You know, we got to help each other. We got to help carry each other's cross, carry each other's burden. You know, call me up. You're going through something. Hey, go to Jesus first. And if you need someone to talk to, call. Let's pray. Amen. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Romans chapter 5, verse 6 to 11. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 to 3, and Romans chapter 12, verse 18. All right? So I was like talking as we were working together, the Lord and I, and honestly, it came to my head, and I was like, so Lord, if a person doesn't forgive, is that like an idol? You know, and I sat there and I was like meditating. And I actually said, okay, let me go a little deep in Google and see, you know, like, thank you, Lord. And I actually found some interesting points, and I want to read it to you guys, you know. You know, of course, I spoke to hubby about it. So he was like, yeah. So it's like, wow, hon, that's actually, like, interesting, you know. But anyways, yeah, so what does God consider an idol, you know? Anything that takes the place of God in our life, in our hearts, is an idol. Anything that becomes more important than him is an idol. Not wanting to forgive a person, you're withholding forgiveness. Doesn't God forgive you when you sin? How many times you've gone to the Lord asking for the same forgiveness? How many times have you gone to the Lord and asked God to forgive you for the same thing? You probably went back like a week ago and you're back again. Lord, forgive me. I'm not going to do it again. How many times? Doesn't God forgive you? God doesn't withhold that from you. He forgives you, you know? And this was very interesting, because the person was like, especially, you know, when we are commanded by God to forgive, like forgive 70 times 7. That means constantly forgiving when someone does wrong to us. Yes, that's the life of a Christian, to stay forgiving when we are hurt. That's just it. We have to forgive. that person is behaving in an idolatrous, I'll spell it, I-D-O-L-A-T-R-O-U-S. Excuse my accent. Idolatrous or pronunciation. Okay. That person's basically trying to be a god, you know, in their own life. They've put themselves before God. They put themselves before God's word, you know. They're refusing to forgive, which is a sin. It's a sin. It's sinning against God, you know, because God spoke about forgiving. So them refusing to forgive, they're sinning against them, the person which has already been forgiven by God. Because them refusing to forgive that person, God has already forgiven that person. God, when he went on the cross, he said, "It is finished. Father, forgive them." He forgave that person. He's just waiting for that person to come and say, "Sorry, Lord, for what I did," you know? So this person who's not forgiving that person that's done them wrong is basically saying, "My feelings are more important than God. And the injury I have endured because of this sin is greater than the challenge to God's holiness." Additionally, the one withholding forgiveness is likewise saying, "All those words in the Bible apply to everyone except me." You know, like basically forgive. If you want to be forgiven, forgive 77 times 7. This person's like, "No, that applies to some others, not me." You know, it's that spirit of pride. So this person's like, "I am above God's law. I am an island of righteousness unto myself, and you must appease me." See, sister, this particular attitude brings me to Exodus 23. Exodus chapter 20, verse 3. And let's see what God says about idols. All right. Exodus chapter 20, verse 3. "Thou shalt have no other gods before me." Okay? And you continue reading. Right there, that person has lifted themselves because they don't want to forgive. They want to hold unforgiveness towards the person that has done them wrong. Christ told the Pharisees, you know, we can turn to it, Matthew chapter 22, 36. What is the greatest commandment? I think, yeah, what is the greatest of the commandments? Matthew 22, verse 36. Excuse me. All right, Matthew 22, verse 36. In Jesus Christ, and we can just start a little bit up, 34. "But when the Pharisees had heard that he had put the Sadducees to silence, they were gathered together. Then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him, and saying, 'Master, which is the great commandment in the law?' Jesus said unto him, 'Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it: Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On this two commandments hang all the law and the prophets.'" So you see here, sister, beloved sister, you have to flee from idolatry. You know, because when we hear idolatry, we're like, "Oh, it's something like, you know, how the Buddha or TV or, you know, like, you name it, fill in the blank." But God revealed today, unforgiveness is an idol when a person doesn't want to flee from it. You got to flee from it. Jesus Christ said, "Flee from idols." Flee from it. You know, doesn't please the Lord. Amen. And with Christ, you can do all things. He can help you forgive. It's good God. You don't have to be bound with that demon. That's why he came. To destroy sin, you know, to set the captives free. Why remain a slave to sin when Christ made a way for you? All you got to do is just reach out to the hem of his garment, and He'll take care of you. Amen. He'll take care of you. He loves you. And I love you, sis. And I know you can do it. Nothing's too hard for the Lord. You just have to believe and trust Him. Trust Him with all your heart. He has a great plan for your future. Great. All right? Just remember that. And think of Jesus Christ. He was the excellent example of forgiveness itself. You know, Jesus Christ was betrayed with Judas for like 30 silvers. His body denied him 3 times. You know, this was a guy that sat in the front row seat, you know, like listening to Jesus' sermons. And when his faith was tested, man, 3 times he denied the Lord. And you know, the Lord warned him. He said, when the cock crows the 3rd time, the Lord warned him. The Lord warned him that he was going to deny him. Probably Peter didn't believe it, you know. But look at the Lord. Think of how many people Christ healed when he was still here. He fed. He taught. The amazing works they seen, but they were probably in the same crowd yelling, crucify him, crucify him. Can you imagine how it made the Lord feel? Jesus Christ is an excellent example of true forgiveness, why we have to look up to him. Because if he did it, we can do it through his help. Because he's inside of us that believe. He sent a spirit to comfort us and to help us, to forgive, to love, to pray for those that do wrong to us. I mean, these are people Jesus, like, he set them free from demons. They turned against him and chose murderer Barabbas over him. And on your own time, you can just read Luke 23, okay? You see the powerful words that Jesus Christ said in Luke 23:34. Powerful. Excellent example. This chapter here, when you get a chance, just read it, you know, read the whole chapter. But the verse I want us to focus on is what Jesus said, you know, while he was on the cross. He said, in Jesus Christ's name, then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Wow. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Can you say that about the one that has tried to destroy your name, lie about you, a husband that treats you so unkindly, cheats on you? You don't feel love from him. A mother that's favored the other children. And you get what I'm trying to say. Can you say that? Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing. You know, gotta have that attitude. Forgive these people that are treating you wrong, because they don't know what they're doing. They're blinded. You know, when we were lost in the world, we were blind. We couldn't see when we were hurting people. I would hurt people and not even care, the old me. Now God has given me a heart that cares. It's amazing what God can do. If you allow him, God really transforms the heart. He gives you a heart of flesh. He removes that heart of stone and he gives you a heart of flesh. You care, you have compassion for others. You don't want to see someone hurting. God gives you his heart. You got to pray for the heart of God. God, give me your heart, Jesus. Give me your heart. Let me feel your pain. Let me feel your pain. Let me love like you love. God will give you that. God will give you that, you know. But he's an excellent example of truly forgiving. Like, think about it. Peter denied him. Like, he walked with Peter. Let's move on to Joseph. Joseph is another one. Joseph was betrayed by his own brothers. They were jealous and envious. If you know the story of Joseph, you can find it in Genesis. It was Genesis 34, I think. Yeah, Genesis chapter 34. You know, you read that and you continue all the way till chapter 45. You see when Joseph reveals himself to his brother, how he carried himself. You know, Joseph suffered a lot. He suffered a lot. He was sold into slavery, you know, and he could have become angry at God and be angry at the people in there. He could have become bitter, you know, but Joseph chose to trust God. He chose to trust God. You see, that's why you can't grow bitter. You can't grow bitter in the place you are right now. You can't even grow bitter with God. You have to trust God where you are right now. You have to. Joseph trusted God, even in the dungeon. That's why the Bible says in Proverbs 3:5, like, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Don't lean on your own understanding. No. Don't lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge God and he will direct your path. Okay? Acknowledge him. Joseph acknowledged God even in the dungeon. Joseph acknowledged God when Potiphar's wife lied about him because she was seducing him and he didn't fall for the devil's temptation. You know, he resisted the temptation. You know, the Bible says resist the devil and he will flee. Flee, right? Amen? And Joseph is still just holding on strong to the Lord, trusting God. And God honored Joseph's faithfulness. And he elevated Joseph. Remember, your elevation comes from not man, but Jesus Christ. Always remember that. God uses man, but God is the one that elevates you. Whether it's a job promotion, you know, God is the one that elevates you. And that's why if you are still working and you've been praying for an elevation, first of all, just know that this world is coming to an end. You know, see all the things going on. But as we're waiting to see what God's doing, and if you've been praying, you know, you pray to God to elevate you. Pray to God to soften the hearts of your workers, your bosses, and God will do that. God will do that. You know, because if your ways are pleasing to the Lord, God even makes your enemies at peace with you. God makes your enemies at peace with you. You find favor with God, you know, at your workplace, wherever you go, God just softens people's hearts and they just want to be a blessing for you. We've seen it. So praise the Lord. I'm telling you, you just got to walk right. Please God, and God's going to take care of you. He is very good. Very good God. Some of you know, but for those that don't know, try the Lord. Taste and see that he is good. He's good. He's good. So strive to walk in holiness. Forgive your enemies. Pray for your enemies. Love your enemies. All right? And you will find favor in the eyes of the Lord. Because that's the fruit of Jesus Christ. You're bearing the fruits of Jesus Christ. Amen? In Matthew chapter 10, verse 36, let's turn to that. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Sisters, we are almost old. We are almost done. 10:36. I hope I didn't put none of you to sleep. Amen. Matthew chapter 10, verse 36. Hallelujah. Right. And a man's foes shall be they of his own household. Joseph, his own enemies were from his own household. Like, they hated their brother. They were jealous, envious of their brother, because their dad favored Joseph, made him a coat of many colors. You know the story. And they didn't want him around. They did not want him around. They wanted him gone. So they sold him into Egypt, you know, but they didn't realize, you know, God had a plan. God had a plan for Joseph and them to deliver them. As you read the story, this is in Genesis, I believe, chapter 34. You read 35, 36, 37, going on till 45, where Joseph finally reveals himself to his brothers, you know. And, man, can you imagine what was going on in Joseph's heart, like, when he seen his brothers, you know. And, of course, they couldn't recognize him because, you know, he probably looked like an Egyptian, you know. And he could see them, but they couldn't see him. So when Joseph reveals himself on the 45th chapter, you read that from verse 1 to 15, we just see that Joseph really, like, he chose to forgive them. Because Joseph was a very powerful man in Egypt. You know, he was Pharaoh's counselor. He was Pharaoh's, like, they said he was like a father to Pharaoh. He was the lord of all his house. He was the ruler throughout all the land of Egypt. This man was a powerful man. Joseph was a very powerful man. So he could have chose to make his brothers become slaves. You know, he could have chose to kill them. But you see, instead, he showed them mercy. He showed them mercy. He showed them the love of God. Because Joseph feared God. Joseph loved the Lord. And he knew vengeance is not his, but vengeance is the Lord's. You know, so he showed them the compassion. So whatever you're going through, you know, you got to learn to show people compassion that least deserve your compassion. Show people love that least deserve your love. Because God is always compassionate towards you, loving towards you. And what God gives you, he wants you to give others, even the ones that don't honestly deserve it. But you do it so that they can come to know Jesus Christ. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? Glory to God, you know, he's allowing me to share testimonies. And that happened to me. A sister that was just so unloving, so hateful, like, tried to even fight me, like, literally fight me, huh? And it was rough to deal with that. But let me tell you, when you're really right in the eyes of the Lord, for real, God makes your enemies be at peace with you, you know? To fast forward it, this woman today, she talks about Jesus, you know? She prays to Jesus. There was a time she didn't want to hear anything about Jesus. And I mentioned Jesus around her, she wanted to beat me. She didn't like to hear, but it was the demons in her. But you see, I didn't take it personal. It bothered me. Of course, there was a time I was like, man, Lord. But God reminded me, the light was too bright and the demons and her couldn't stand me being around because the light of Christ was too bright for the demons. They would irritate and so they would manifest out of her, you know. But praise God, God taught me how to, you know, call on Jesus Christ and the demons just get bound. You know, it's a long story, but Jesus' love through me drew her to want to know God. You know, there's a scripture that says, when we do good works, when we glorify God, we show God's goodness, it makes others want to know God, and they start glorifying God, you know. And I've just been seeing that with her. She's getting better. What a huge transformation. Huge transformation, you know. And then there was this other one. The sister's actually in the ministry. She had a sister that knew me when I was lost in the world. And this woman would call me up to kind of like have me relive the old me. So mean to do. You know what I mean? Like, try to remind me of how I used to smoke weed and, like, what did I do with my life? Wasted my life. Yeah, she was not a nice girl, you know? I hope she's really saved wherever she is. But she had such pride in her master's degrees, PhDs, and all this stuff. But you see, because I was walking with the Lord, I loved the Lord, still love my Lord, God fought for me. So when she would call me, I'm excited. I'm like, time to minister, you know? And I'm there, like, ready to minister to her. But she's there to, like, try to cause me to relive my past. And I'm like, sis, why do you keep calling me if you are not interested in giving your life to the Lord? You know? So I kind of left her alone. You know, I prayed for her. Fast forward. Do you know this woman? She had all those PhDs. She had the PhD, master's degree, but could not get a job. She could not get a job because her inward was unclean. She was jealous of my liberty in Christ, my freedom. She's looking at me. She's like, this chick don't even have a degree. You know what I mean? Like, look at her. She's joyful. She's married. She's got two children. She couldn't comprehend my blessings from God. So God shut the door for her. She couldn't get the job with her degrees because she would boast about her degrees. Hey, Jesus is Lord. Jesus takes the foolish things of this world to conform the wise. God resisted the proud and he gives grace to the humble. She couldn't get a job. The job for her degree, she couldn't get that. Door was shut. She had to work at Walmart. Imagine what God can do. God don't like to see those that love him get picked on, being mistreated. Nah. And her life is, she ended up getting married to an old man. It's a sad story because she would not submit unto the Lord. She would not. Well, God allowed me to share that. I'm telling you, I forgot about that. Oh, how good is God. Thank you, Lord. Of course I pray for her. I never stopped praying for that woman. But I know God punished her. Punished her for trying to discourage the growing me in the Lord. You know, I didn't allow no unforgiveness to come towards me by the grace of God. I prayed. I would pray for her. That's the secret. You pray for your enemies. For real, it works. It keeps you protected. It keeps you protected. Don't pray for God to bless them. Pray for God to change their hearts. Pray for God to save them that they don't burn for eternity. And I pray that wherever she is, if she ends up watching this, I pray that you really see that the hand of God was against your ways. And that you repent before it's too late for you. And understand that God truly resisted the proud and he gives grace to the humble. He loves you. That's why he allowed that door to be shut. I hope it's well with you in your marriage. I pray you prosper and have children if it's God's will. But don't play with this living God. He's real. Amen. Repent. I love you. Jesus Christ is Lord. So know this, sisters. If you have been around a person that looks down on you, you know, don't take it personal. Just pray for them. Pray for them, love them, and one day, hopefully, they give their life to the Lord. All right? They'll give their life to the Lord. And it's all about that, winning people to Christ. You know, winning people to Christ. And yeah, God actually just reminded me. She actually, the woman actually started calling on the Thursday night conference calls. You know, listening to the word of God being preached through my husband. You know, so really keep her in prayer that she's moving closer and closer to a true born-again experience. And not a fake salvation, but a true born-again. Like, she really follows and fears the Lord and obeys the word of God. Amen? Because if I allowed her to get to me, I would have probably been a bitter person and be miserable and doubt my calling, you know. But you see, when God has called a person, human beings cannot comprehend. You know, they cannot comprehend, like, why are you so passionate about this? When God has called you, and you know he has called you. Remember, many are called, but few are chosen. That's the word right there. When God has chosen you, he has chosen you for a task. It's you and the Lord. Others cannot understand. So you have to stay focused. And that's why you have to stay praying. And because the enemy will try to use people to make you miss your calling, make you not focus on what God planned for your life. And a lot of people have missed out on amazing, amazing, amazing things that God had for them because they chose to follow the world and go back to the world instead of following Jesus Christ. All right? Just remember, your reward is in heaven, all right? The prayer of a righteous man availeth much. God had me go on just a different, like the wind, right? Right, James. So the prayer of a righteous man availeth much. James 5:16, James 1, chapter 1, verse 1 to 8, James 5:8, Romans 5, chapter 3, is it chapter 3? Romans chapter 5, verse 3 to 6. And then 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 7, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, and Matthew chapter 5, verse 11 to 12. Okay? And this is just still about forgiveness, scriptures on forgiveness. And then the other one quickly is King David. You know, King David, any of you that have read the story of King David, and those that have not, please go read it. 1 Samuel, see, you know, it's about King David. You can start from the beginning or if you just want to jump. But I think it's better. Start from the beginning so you understand. You know, King David, we see that he refused to kill King Saul. You know, when Saul became very jealous of David's promotion, the people loved David. He became very jealous that he plotted to wanting to kill David. And David had to run, you know. Let's go ahead to 1 Samuel chapter 24, verse 1. Okay, we can read that real quick in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. First Samuel. I said 1 Samuel 24. Okay. Whew. Thank you, Lord. Mm. That was a tough story, yeah. I feel really bad. We're very sorry for her, but you know, God's will be done in her life. I totally forgot about I forgot about that. It's amazing how God will allow the mind to forget certain things, but then when the time's right, he brings it forward. He like just brought it, and like now I'm just like still thinking about it. I gotta go back here, all right? Thank you, Lord. So 1 Samuel 24. We can read this. Starting from verse 1, in Jesus Christ's name. And it came to pass, when Saul was returned from following the Philistines, that it was told him, saying, Behold, David is in the wilderness of Engedi. Then Saul took 3,000 chosen men out of all Israel, and went to seek David and his men upon the rocks of the wild goats. And he came to the sheepcotes, by the way, where was a cave, and Saul went in to cover his feet. And David and his men remained in the sides of the cave. And the men of David said unto him, Behold, the day of which the Lord said unto thee, Behold, I will deliver thine enemy into thine hand, that thou mayest do to him as it shall seem good unto you. Then David arose and cut off the skirt of Saul's robe privately. See what these men were trying to give David, bad advice, like, yeah. And it came to pass afterward that David's heart smote him, because he had cut off Saul's skirt. And he said unto his men, The Lord forbid that I should do this thing unto my master, the Lord's anointed, to stretch forth mine hand against him, seeing he's the anointed of the Lord. So David stayed his servants with these words, and suffered them not to rise against Saul. But Saul rose up out of the cave and went on his way. David also arose afterward and went out of the cave and cried after Saul, saying, My Lord the king. Hey, check that out. This man had respect for a man that still wanted to kill him. It's because David respected the anointing. My Lord the king. And when Saul looked behind him, David stooped with his face to the earth and bowed himself. Wow. And David said to Saul, Wherefore hearest thou men's words, saying, Behold, David seeketh thy heart. Behold, this day thine eyes have seen how that the Lord had delivered thee today into mine hand in the cave. And some bade me kill thee, but my eyes spared thee. And I said, I will not put forth mine hand against my Lord, for he is the Lord's anointed. What? You hear that? He respected the anointing that was on Saul's life. This day and age we're in, people don't respect the anointing of God and the servants of the Lord. It's a wicked generation of vipers. Brood, wicked generation of vipers. Don't be one of those people that don't respect God's anointing and a servant of the Lord. All right? Gotta respect the anointing of the Lord. Verse 11. Moreover, my father, he called him my father. My father, see the skirt of thy robe in my hand. For in that I cut off the skirt of thy robe and killed thee not. Know thou and see that there is neither evil nor transgression in mine hand, and I have not sinned against thee. Yet thou huntest my soul to take it. The Lord judge between me and thee, and the Lord avenge me of thee, but mine hand shall not be upon thee. See that? You can finish reading, but it's just amazing how this man was after trying to kill King David. King David comes in contact with him, cuts off the skirt of Saul's privately, Saul didn't even feel it. And then when they come in contact, he shows him, like, look, I could have killed you. You know, it's so interesting because I seen back, like, I think it was Samuel 15, when I was reading one time, you know, when Saul, when he disobeyed the Lord and Samuel came and checked him, and when Samuel was walking away, Saul cut off part of his skirt, you know, he tore the hem of his robe, you know. So it's very interesting that what he had done to Samuel, the prophet, it got done to him like a few chapters later by King David, you know. Something there, hun, show us what the Lord is telling us there. You, my husband, John the Revelator. Amen. Wally the Revelator. Hallelujah. Boneso sifiwe. So, forgiveness, more powerful than vengeance, right? King David was not going to touch that man. He let God deal with Saul. And we see later on what happened to Saul, you know? In God's timing, God deals with your enemies. Don't take things in your own hands, you know, and try to deal with your enemies. God is talking about somebody trying to work witchcraft, you know. Don't go to a witch doctor to try to do some curse on your husband, you know, or someone that's hurt you. Don't do it. Don't do it. It's that's what the devil wants you to do. Render evil for evil. No. We children of God don't render evil for evil. We do good. We show kindness. The more we show kindness, it puts coals of fire on that person's head. And they don't know what to do. They have to surrender to the Lord. All right? And we see that this man, David, showed respect to his king still. You know? Was not the nicest king, but he still showed him the respect, reverence. He had such reverence for him, you know. Always forgive. Forgiveness stronger, greater than vengeance. Vengeance is the Lord, says the Lord God. Compassion more powerful than anger, you know. Compassion more powerful than anger. Be slow to anger. Be quick to forgive. James 1:19, verse 20. Hallelujah. James 1:19, 20. In Jesus Christ's name. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. For the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. Right there. So, the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. That's why God's like, when you feel anger rising up, you feel like your blood is like trying to make you do something that is going to cause you to regret, you got to walk away. Go pray. That's practicing self-control. It's fruit of the Spirit. Because that anger will not bring out good fruit. A person ends up regretting it, you know. The person ends up regretting it. So always learn to pray and walk away. It's the best choice one can make. Proverbs 16:32, whoever is slow to anger is better than the mighty, and he who rules his spirit than he who takes the city. Gotta have rule over your spirit. Take control over your spirit. Don't let your spirit be defiled with anger, ungodly anger. Another man that was that his story touched me as well, is Stephen. You know, you find that in the book of Acts, chapter 7. When Stephen, God blessed him, he was able to do miracles, signs, and wonders. The demons, you know, came through the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Very angry and they plotted against him. They lied. They basically bore false witness, accusations against him. Just get some time on your own leisure and read the story of what happened to our brother Stephen, our late brother Stephen. Book of Acts, chapter 7. Okay? Let's turn to it. I want us to focus on verse 54 and 60 because it's a very long chapter. In Acts chapter 7, where are you? All right, there we go. So yeah, please read that. Read and see, you know, what happened. He just basically was breaking it down to them about Abraham and their forefathers, how God delivered them from Egypt, brought them to Moses. You know, Moses, 40 years went back. He breaks it down to them, you know, when they brought him to the high priest. These hateful men, they brought Stephen, the synagogue, to say, what is it we're hearing about? Because they were lying. There were people that were lying about Stephen, you know, saying that he's saying some false things about Moses, you know, just false accusations, basically. So Stephen was breaking it down to them about how, you know, God called Abraham to follow him, and he goes down to Joseph, how God allowed Joseph to become a slave, and Joseph was used to deliver his people. And then he breaks down, he goes to Jacob, and then Moses, how God used Moses to deliver them out of Egypt, you know. And he comes to this point, he says the Holy Ghost now was full in him, you know, like, and they didn't like it. The demons and those men did not like what he said because he was full of the Holy Ghost. Now we can go there. That's chapter 7, book of Acts, verse 54. We can start reading. No, actually, I love from verse 50. Look at this. In Jesus Christ's name, he says, "You stiff, naked, and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you do always resist the Holy Ghost. As your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted? And they have slain them which shewed before of the coming of the just one, of whom you have been now the betrayers and murderers, who have received the law by the disposition of angels and have not kept it. When they heard these things, they were cut to their heart, and they gnashed on him with their teeth. But he, Stephen, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God, and said, Behold, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. Then they cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears and ran up upon him with one accord." These were devils now really coming at him. They were coming at him. The devils coming at him because they were convicted. Reminded where they're going to go. The power of the Holy Ghost was there to remind them, you are going to get punished for eternity. Verse 58. "And cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their clothes at a young man's feet whose name was Saul. And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep." He basically asked God to forgive them after getting beat, stoned, man. Can you imagine how big those stones were? But this man, he remembered. He followed his Savior's footsteps. He forgave them, and he fell asleep. Wow. Can you imagine those men, if they died and did not repent? As we speak right now, they're burning in hell. Burning in hell. It's bad to have a stiff neck and a hard heart. We gotta be obedient people, willing to be corrected, knowing that those the Lord loves, he corrects, because he loves us. So he corrects us because he doesn't want us to perish. We gotta be willing. So these men, these Pharisees, Sadducees, they were stiff-necked. Their hard heart, their hearts were hardened. They didn't want to hear what Stephen had to say. They didn't believe in him. They didn't believe. So, blessed are you when men shall persecute you. Rejoice. Wow. Wow. You know, time's coming. Some of us are not going to taste death, and some of us are going to taste death. It's what God wills. You know, stuff is coming. Going to be killed for our faith. So we have to build our spirit now. Start getting stronger in the Lord now. That, God forbid, if you're put in that situation, you're not going to convert to Islam. You're going to remain firm in Jesus Christ, knowing that he's right there with you. Stephen saw Jesus. Can you imagine that? That's amazing. That's amazing. Just gives a person excitement, like, oh God, kill me. I'm going to see the Lord. I'm going home. You know? Matthew chapter 5, verse 10. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. That's the scripture. He was persecuted for the kingdom of God. Persecuted for righteousness' sake. You know? John 16, 2. These men thought they were doing God's service. John, the Gospel of John. They thought they were doing God's service by killing Stephen. Not knowing they're doing the devil's deed. In Jesus Christ's name, they shall put you out of the synagogues. Didn't they do this to Stephen? Yet. The time cometh that whosoever killeth you will think that he doeth God's service. They did this to Stephen. They pulled him out of the synagogue and stoned him. Killed him. Killed the man. For what? For telling them the truth. The truth is hated in this time we're living in because it's offending. The truth is an offense. But we have to continue speaking the truth. Speak the truth in love. Speak the truth in love. Amen. Scary thing is falling into the hands of a living God. It's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. I don't know if you've ever felt God's presence on you in the closet. Felt that the other day. Oh my goodness. Very trembling. You know, there are different ways how the Lord would want to come. You know, he comes, at times he comes very gentle, and I feel this like peace and like, wow, love, and you know. And then the last time he came, I felt, it was like the judge came, you know, and I felt such tremble. I trembled. I really did. It was a fearful. Like even the Bible says, we trembled at his presence. Fearful. John fell dead at Jesus' presence, you know? Yeah, it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of a living God. Those people that are caught gonna die and refuse the free gift of salvation. Chose to live for the devils and denied God's son Jesus Christ. It's a fearful thing. Let none of us be there. Let none of us be there. Let us make it in. Let us make it in. Amen. Let us make it in. Ay, ay, ay. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. All right. As we're wrapping up the message, praise God. As you remember, the message was a prison of unforgiveness, you know? And it made me think when Paul and Silas were in prison. If you remember the story when Paul and Silas were put in prison because God used Paul to deliver a woman from a spirit of divination. And her masters were very upset with Paul. So they put Paul and flogged him. They beat him. They beat Silas too. Paul and Silas, right? And then they put him into prison. We can go to it. Acts chapter 16. Read the whole chapter for yourself. But I'm coming to the places where I was talking about, you know. Yeah, so we'll start from verse 16. So in Jesus Christ's name, and it came to pass as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with the spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. The same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. And this did she many days. But Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the spirit, he spoke to the spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out the same hour. And when her masters saw that the hope of their gains was gone, their puppet, they couldn't use it no more. They caught Paul and Silas and drew them into the marketplace unto the rulers and brought them to the magistrates, saying, these men being Jews do exceedingly trouble our city and teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Romans. And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrates rent off their clothes and commanded to beat them. Why? What did they do? But that's how you know spiritual warfare. These demons, they go really psycho inside people that are don't have Jesus Christ, you know? People that are possessed by evil spirits, they get used as tools to do the devil's deeds. What did Paul and Silas do? They did a good deed. They delivered through the power of the Holy Ghost a woman from a divination spirit being, you know. Anyways, in Jesus Christ's name. And when they laid, verse 23, and when they laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely. Who, having received such a charge, thrust them into their inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. Midnight hour. Yes. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's bands were loosed. See, instead of Paul and Silas sitting there and cry and feel sorry for them, remember, they were beaten. They were probably bleeding, you know, in pain. But they counted all joy to suffer for the name of Jesus Christ. And they started praising the Lord, singing songs unto the Lord. Goes Judah plows the way. Devils hate it when you truly sing to God. And we see what happened. Earthquake came. God sent an earthquake. It came, shook the prison cells, set captives free. You know, all the prisoners in there were set free. And when the jailer came and he found that the doors were open, he was ready to kill himself. But Paul, he had no grudge. He cried out with a loud voice, "Do thyself no harm," verse 28, "for we are all here." Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house." And they spoke unto him the word of the Lord and to all that were in the house. And he took them the same hour of the night and washed their stripes and was baptized, he and all his straightway. Amazing. See how God turned all that? Paul and Silas, that day as they were going to the marketplace and doing that job, they didn't know they were going to end up going into a prison and end up saving a man with his household. And not only the man, other prisoners in there probably got saved. Okay. You know? So, sis, this is the question I have for you. You know, Paul, they chose to forgive. They chose to care for this soul and not, you know, have a grudge on him. You know, the Bible says in Luke 15:10, love it. Love it. Luke 15:10. Hallelujah. Luke 15:10. And I'm sorry if I've been very fast with the, you know, scriptures. I apologize. Luke 15:10. "Likewise, I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repented." They celebrate in heaven. They're so excited for that one sinner that gave their life to the Lord. Now, this man had family, gave their life to the Lord, you know. So the question is, sis, are you willing to forgive that person that has been used by the enemy to wound your spirit? Are you willing to let go? As we've gone through the scriptures, and you have a lot of scriptures that you can study at your own time, allow the Holy Spirit to help you really understand, you will see the need for you to let go of that spirit. We've seen how dangerous it can be if a person continually keeps walking in that way. And we've seen the results of one forgiving, how good it's for them. You know? So Paul and Silas chose to not allow grudge to affect their work service for the Lord there. They immediately intervened when that man was about to put a sword and kill himself, because they knew that man was going to go to hell. Be willing to intervene on whoever is trying to destroy your life. If you're led by the Lord, pray and see if God's leading you to make a few phone calls and tell the person that has hurt you, or the persons that has hurt you, that you forgive them. You forgive them, you love them, and for them to repent and give their life to the Lord, because they are not promised tomorrow. You've done your part. You've done your part. I remember when I came to the Lord, and we're wrapping up, God had me, because I had this best buddy, you know, we went to school together, high school together, then college. I ended up going to California. She ended up going to Minnesota. And when she ended up moving to, because when I moved away from California, I moved to Boston, a little city of Worcester. And she ended up moving there. She came from Minnesota and she ended up moving to Worcester. And anyways, to make the story short, things happened between us, you know, both lost in the world, don't have Christ, friendship don't usually last. And she ended up going her way, but she ended up going very bitter. You know, I wasn't nice to her. The old me was not nice to her, you know. And when I found Jesus, the Lord reminded me about her, even gave me the phone number to call her at work. That's just how God works. I was so happy. There was no pride. I was ready to do what God told me to do. So I called her, and I called her by name, and she was happy to hear from me. And I said, I'm so sorry for what I did to you. Please forgive me. It was selfish of me, and God is in my life. And I just started telling her about the Lord, you know, and it just felt so good. It felt so good to just call and ask for forgiveness for where I went wrong. Just saying, even if you didn't go wrong, just let that person know you forgive them. You forgive them and you love them. And if they ever want to know about the Lord, you're there, you know. But again, just know that forgiveness doesn't mean you go back to that person. No, no, no. Sometimes God just wants you to forgive and leave that person alone and just pray for them from far, love them from far, but don't go around them, because they got to be willing to want to change. You don't want them demons to try to sneak in and try to make your life miserable. Remember, you forgiving is for your own good. All right? It's not about them. It's for your own good. You shut the doors and you allow God's doors to be open to bless you, that you may produce fruit for Jesus Christ. Fruits for Jesus Christ. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Amen. I think that's about it. Honestly, guys, we're done. Thank you, Lord. We're done. All we got to do now is pray. So let us pray together and ask the Lord to keep the word inside of us, that the enemy does not steal the word. All right? Thank you, Lord. Whew. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Wonderful counselor, the Prince of Peace, the Alpha and Omega, the bread of life, the living water. Oh, Jesus Christ. Thank you for the word you've blessed us with. I pray that you will add living water and holy light to all the seeds you planted in us. Don't let the enemy snatch the word out of our hearts. Hide the word of God in our hearts, Lord Jesus, that we bear fruit, O God. I pray for the sister or sisters that are struggling with unforgiveness. I pray that, God, you will soften their heart. In the name of Jesus Christ, that you would touch that wound and heal it, O God, and that the word that was spoken into their hearts today will be a word that will liberate them, that word liberated them, healed them, blessed them, and that give them the heart to forgive, Jesus. Give them a new heart, creating them a new and a clean heart to forgive. Draw them to your word. Cause them to become so hungry for the word of God so that their mind is renewed. Your word says, blessed are they that hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Please may they hunger and thirst after your righteousness, Lord, that you may fill them, Lord God. May they overcome every pride, every tactics of Satan. May they overcome it. Give them the strength to overcome it. May the same mind that was in you, Christ Jesus, be upon them, Lord God. May you remind them, you commanded us to forgive 70 times 7. Please, Lord, remind them that they will forgive and that they will not be a victim, but they will be conquerors, victorious, in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus Christ's name, I give you the glory, the honor, and the praise. Amen. Hallelujah to the King of Kings. Love you guys. See you again, Lord willing, as I'm led.
To the Lord, say this with all your heart, with all your heart.
My Lord, I believe that you died for me. My Lord, and on the third day, rise for me. My Lord, please forgive me for all my sins, because all I want is the Holy Spirit Christ in me. My Lord, wash away all my sins. My Lord, forgive my enemies, forgive my friends. My Lord, give me truth when they lie to me. And when the enemy comes, Lord, fight for me.
Fight for us. Always had the power, man. Always had the power. Read Revelations, read the book of Genesis. Power over everything that dwells on the earth. In the name and by the power of Jesus Christ. The end is coming sooner than you think. Who's saved around you, man? It's not a game. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus Christ.